All right, welcome everybody. So this is going to be the first of two videos on how to peer review in HCI. And this is going to be a way of doing best practice, and there's going to be two halves to it. The first part, we're going to look at generally understanding the peer review process. And then in the second part, we'll look at actually doing a review, like reading the paper and writing the review. So in this first part, yeah, we're focusing on understanding. But before we begin, I'll introduce a bit about myself and where my understanding comes from, because my understanding has only come from the way I've been trained and taught by other people. And so it comes from the experience I have across different types of reviewing. So my name is Max Wilson. I'm an associate professor at the University of Nottingham. And I've had various reviewing roles over time that I'm going to be basing this advice on. Most recently, I've been papers chair for CHI 2023 and CHI 2024. But in parallel to that, I'm also a deputy editor at one of the big HCI journals that we have, IJHCS. But across all my other roles, I've been a reviewer, I've been a senior reviewer or associate chair. I've been a subcommittee chair for a certain area of CHI. I've been an area chair for smaller conferences, which is responsible for a group of senior reviewers. I've been workshop chair, poster chair, courses chair, panels chair, all these different types of chairs for different bits of different conferences. And separate to that, I've also been an organizer in a few series of workshops. So some of the experience I have is being like a workshop organizer. So these videos have come from a bigger course that I teach, and I'm available to teach these. I try and teach them in different places, such as at conferences. And what you get from this training is both a mixture of knowledge and understanding about what's happening in the background, and then also practice for knowing what you should put into a review. And this could be like a day-long course sometimes, but it's also possible for more focused training to do specific bits. And in a way, that's what this video is. This video, or these two videos, are going to be about the understanding part, so that you have the knowledge necessary behind the reviewing process in order to be a good reviewer for yourself. So what's going to be in this particular video? Really, what I'm going to try and do is take you through five levels of context which are important to understand in order to be able to be a good reviewer, to know what you're doing, to review correctly for the given situation. And this goes across understanding the types of papers that we're going to be reviewing, understanding the types of venues that these papers have been submitted to, understanding the people that are involved in the process, the processes they're using, and then ultimately what decisions those people are making. And so to be a good reviewer, or to be good at reviewing, is what I say, you kind of need to understand all five of these levels of context, because then for every situation you're going to be in, you'll be taking some combination of them. And so this is really important, because the most common mistake we see, especially with new reviewers, for example, is that they come into the reviewing situation, maybe the first time, and they are reviewing one type of paper, but using what they've been trained to do for another type of paper. So a common example within HCI, and if I pick CHI specifically as one type of conference that we have, we see people reviewing late-breaking work submissions at the same level and mindset as, you know, maybe a full academic paper, as a full paper at a conference or as a journal. And the criteria aren't really exactly the same, and the expectations aren't the same. And so when you apply one type of way of reviewing to another type of situation, that's when you get papers which are perhaps unfairly rejected, or not quite reviewed for the right purpose. And this was some advice I got from Gareth over what used to be Twitter, as part of the advice I was just seeking from different community members. So let's think first about the types of paper and places we send things. And what I try and do normally when we do this is normally as an exercise, is we try and get people to think about all the different types of things people might write, and then think about the pressures and importance behind those types of papers being reviewed at those venues. So on one axis here, I've got the kind of importance, like how big and critical and good is this paper. And on the horizontal axis there, I have the kind of time pressure involved in deciding how and where it will be published. And then you could put different types of things on there. And I've got a few examples, but, you know, with more time and more activity, we can go through lots of examples. So for example, a full conference paper is obviously, you know, very important. It's going to be one of the best things a lot of us will produce in HCI. And it's got a high time pressure on it in that there is a deadline for the conference, maybe a couple, which might cycle around across the year. And in that process, it's going to be decided that one time whether it's in or out and then be accepted or rejected. Comparatively, journal articles, also very excellent publications, and they are put into journals and they don't have that same sense of time pressure. So I have them on the left in terms of time pressure. They are more focused on getting quality out there and don't really have any immediate like deadline to get stuff out. There is more and more pressure in journals that we'll talk about later, but there's not like a one point in time decision like in conferences. So then you think about other types of things you might write, and you know, there's all sorts of things, but you could be writing a workshop paper to submit to a workshop, and that workshop might be at a conference. And so those are interesting. They're not the best papers we might produce. They're not like full research conference papers, but they are maybe interesting and exciting to talk about. And they are normally put into a kind of time pressure timeline. You have to submit for the workshop at a certain point, and there's going to be a decision point in there. But normally workshops are a bit more flexible than that. You know, they might extend their deadline because they want more people to submit some interesting papers, and then they can be a bit relaxed about how long they take to decide on them, and they might be able to accept some late submissions. You know, all those things because it's the kind of size and importance of the paper is lower, if that makes sense. And you can think same for like conference posters. Conference posters are a good first type of publication to come out, but not going to be your full version of your research as a full conference paper. But being at the conference and being in the conference's timelines, there's going to be like a deadline and a decision point, and you're going to be in or out at that certain point. So all of those I see as time pressure created by conferences, whereas other things like books, or for example, book chapters, they might be more along the lines of journal with less time pressure, sometimes scheduled, but not really like fixed dates or things get rejected or not. So what you tend to find is that all of these places, depending on how important that is, that thing we're submitting to, have these formal models of reviewing that they're adhering to. And this is something that I didn't really learn or really understand for maybe a good 8 years of being an academic, as a researcher, as a PhD student. It took me a number of years to really understand these formal terms that were behind what was happening in conferences. So the top one is the refereed type of reviewing process. And this means that things that are submitted to that venue, if it's a refereed process, it means that they will have at least one opportunity to provide major revisions before a paper is accepted. Basically, it has to have a major revisions process in the reviewing process in order for it to be refereed and for a venue to have refereed status. The next one, which is for most conferences, I would say, is formally peer reviewed. And this is the word formally there is what matters, I guess. But that's when things are submitted to a venue like a conference, and then they get peer reviewed by at least, for example, three external reviewers, and then get a meta review. And then there might be a rebuttal involved, which is fine. That's where an author can say, actually, you misunderstood something, and then they reconsider it. But ultimately, it's peer reviewed and then decided, as opposed to having a refereed major revisions process. So then after that, what you get is some of these lower levels, and you might see the word reviewed in there, and you might find that some workshops or some other conferences, they might pick reviewed as opposed to formally peer reviewed. And under reviewed, what you'd expect is that you might get some reviews in, but those reviews are like maybe a paragraph long and kind of just deciding whether it's interesting or relevant to the workshop and should or should not be accepted. They're kind of judged and lightly reviewed is maybe a good way of looking at it. So then after that is what you have is highly edited. And what's interesting is that this is true for lots of things like some books where actually they're not so much reviewed, but they're actually edited. So they're not getting extensive reviews from external reviewers, but there is an editor, person in charge, and that editor is sort of co-generating the content that's going to be in them. And so they are often good things to produce, but not kind of peer-reviewed or refereed in a more formal way. And then you have some things which are unreviewed, as you know, as a possibility. And if you want to see from that link below, you can find and read all these kind of formal terms. But what is important for you to maybe understand as a reviewer is that everything above this line counts as an archival publication. And anything that's had less formal reviewing is typically non-archival. And that's an important term. Archival or non-archival means whether it's something that counts as having been formally published and can't be republished. It's above the archival line. And the stuff that's non-archival is typically early work or early drafts of papers, which typically get then published later in more formal terms. So I hope that's useful. That's something that took me many years to really understand the formality behind. And so hopefully by watching this video, you've gained this from the very beginning. So some interesting notes on what that means for refereed. You'll find that journals are typically refereed in how they work, in that they expect there to be revision cycles to go through. And it doesn't really matter how long it takes. It just needs to go through revision cycles until it's good enough to be accepted and published. What you might want to judge as someone who's new to reviewing or new to publishing is that we find lots of spam journals, for example, will be offering to kind of go through that process as a guaranteed way and try and get through it quickly, and often to accept papers first time without really being properly reviewed and refereed. And so that's something that we kind of look out for. And a good high quality journal, which hopefully we're all working towards trying to publish in and trying to review for, there will be this formality behind the review process, and things really do get judged for whether they should be accepted or not. What's quite interesting, if you want to understand the context of our research community against lots of other research communities, is that mature fields of research, which you might think maybe physics and chemistry are these mature fields, they consider conferences which might be formally reviewed as not as good as journals which are refereed. So typically in those other fields, they will publish their best work in refereed journals, and conferences in their field are not at the same level. Their conferences are more like these kind of more like workshops we have in our community. And so one thing that conferences have been trying to do to be understood better by other fields or neighboring fields is to build up our conferences to being refereed status. So this is why conferences like CSCW, for example, has these regular cycles which allow for major revisions and therefore allow for the publication process to be of refereed status rather than formally peer-reviewed. This is why CHI similarly added the revise and resubmit process, so there is at least one point where major revisions can happen, and this also allows it to establish a more refereed status of publishing. And we've seen some of our conferences in the HCI community more broadly have moved over to publishing the outcomes of papers submitted to conferences to PACM, the Proceedings of the ACM. And this is to produce a journal output rather than a conference output. So one thing we're seeing a little bit in HCI at the moment is that venues are kind of trying to upgrade and add more formality to their processes in order to get more recognized levels of publishing coming out. So it's good for you as a reviewer to know these things. And if you can estimate whether or not you're reviewing for something which is aiming at the refereed level, it helps you judge the kind of level at which you're adding formality to when you provide your review. Something that's complicated, though, is that I guess not all venues are necessarily equal. So there are some excellent journals and excellent conferences, and they are working with high demand, with lots of people trying to submit the best work to these most influential venues to publish in. And they have this kind of aim where they're trying to get absolutely the most formal process they can for reviewing, and to only accept the absolute best through that process. And they're trying to really identify the absolute best. Some venues, some conferences are newer conferences and are still establishing their track record. And they're often trying to encourage more contributions from the community and to build a reputation. And so they are looking for papers or contributions that fit the conference that are of good quality. And so they're trying to draw a line perhaps at a different level. Rather than finding the absolute best, they're trying to find excellence within their scope. And this means that as a reviewer, you are sometimes moderating the bar that you are estimating at. So you've got to try and establish what this conference is looking for. And usually this is clear. Usually they're trying to say, this is the criteria we want you to evaluate, and to tell us, does it fit this criteria? And that will then be within the conference's bar of quality or estimations they're looking for. Sometimes you're reviewing for a venue where they really are looking for the absolute top 1% of what's being submitted. And in that case, you would expect their guidance to say, you know, is this in the best papers you've seen this year type criteria? Something else that's good to know is that these some conferences in other fields or related fields, certainly some of our neighboring research areas, consider their conferences and what's submitted to those conferences as more like the way we see workshops, as in places where we submit interesting content but aren't aiming to formally publish. And in these cases, they are providing lighter touch reviews to talk about what is interesting for the conference rather than is this right for publication. So that's complicated, right? There's a big mix of things there. There's types of papers, types of different time pressures, types of or levels of bar of quality that they're all aiming for. And as a reviewer, you want to try and understand what you're currently doing or where you're providing a review right now. So far, this means to be a good reviewer, you have to understand the type of thing you're reviewing for, the pressures driving the decision, and then also the relative bar of quality for that particular instance of that venue. So first check, think about that in your head when you're going to be writing a review.